Dr. Kim, Peter, welcome to the show. It is such an honor to have you here. I have to tell you, and we talked about it in the pre-talk, your new book, your great new book, How Trust Works, The Science of How Relationships Are Built, Broken, and Repaired, really surprised me. And I want to get into that a little bit. But first of all, welcome. It's great to have you here.
Thank you, Art. It's a pleasure to chat with you.
So, you know, what I had anticipated picking up, and I don't know why, it's just kind of assumption. I get a lot of books in the world, and I look forward to the, you know, 8 lessons I needed to strengthen trust with the people around me. And that's not what I got from this book. And I was so happy not to get that. This effectively is 20 years of your life. So give us a little perspective as to where this comes from and what you're seeking to achieve with the book.
Sure. So this book has been the product of really my effort to understand how we relate to one another in the world. So this is a question that I think we all have. And it gets to the fact that trust is such a vital part of all of our lives. And if I were to ask anyone how important trust is to you, I have no doubt they would say it's vital. The research I've done on this topic, based on that recognition, however, has repeatedly found that despite how important trust is, we often manage it quite poorly. And so time and time again, these studies have found that little differences in wording, idiosyncratic features of the situation, things that have nothing to do with the actual trustworthiness of the person in question, can make such a dramatic difference in the trust we exhibit. And so my book was an attempt to dig beneath the surface to really capture those nuances, things that we don't necessarily anticipate, to highlight the assumptions that we might have about how this works that are wrong, and to really unpack this phenomenon to a degree where we can have deeper insight into this phenomenon.
What a great stage setter. So, I mean, if you look around us too in the world, what's going on, it kind of feels like trust or the lack thereof is the issue at this point in time. I think we have a crisis in trust, and some of the data in your book early on suggests that that's the case.
That's absolutely true. Every survey I've seen has indicated that trust has been in the decline, not only in one another, but in our institutions and government and so on. And this is all around the world. So this is a serious issue. And it's especially the case in the United States, where every survey has exhibited a dramatic decline in trust.
So, I mean, if you think about it, trust is one of those fundamental human issues. It's been an issue forever, of survival, right? We trust the right person and we survive. We trust the wrong person and maybe we're endangered. And then as an amateur historian, an emphasis on the word amateur, as I look through history, I mean, so many wars and issues and conflagrations, you know, relatively recently, the entire Cold War had this aura of distrust hanging around it. And the things that we're dealing with today in our world, you know, from the political polarization and those issues, it is everywhere. I think it's one of the core issues, not only of our time, but maybe of humanity's time. Is that a little melodramatic?
No, I share your view. And that's what ultimately motivated me to write the book, because from a scientific standpoint, I'm not done. There's so much more we have to learn. And if it were just up to me in normal times, I would continue doing the research, trying to understand more of this phenomenon before I were to write a book like this. But I felt compelled to write this book based on what I've uncovered so far, simply because I felt that urgency.
What a timely offering out there. And again, as I said, so positively surprised by the depth, the research, and the way you approach the topic. And we'll dig into that a little bit. I do have to ask you, though. I'm a big fan of always reading the introductions, the author's notes, and the conclusions. And all right, truth serum, I read those all first. And then I dive into the content the rest of the way. You open with a fascinating backstory, the history of your parents coming to this country. And maybe you could share just the short snippet of it. We want people to read it in the book. And I'm curious why you included that at the opening. And I have my own theory, but I'm curious on your rationale.
Well, that is not a story I've shared very often. Okay. What's in the introduction? I guess it's before the introduction, the author's note. I share it is because I felt in a way obliged to convey that even though I'm a social scientist needing to study this phenomenon in as objective a way as I can, for the sake of the science to really reach reliable conclusions, that this topic is not an arm's length topic for me. I, like so many others who might be interested in this topic, have had real experiences with mm-hmm. trust, its violation, and the real risks and fears that are associated with making oneself vulnerable. And so that's why I shared those stories.
So powerful. And again, readers of the book will get this immediate, powerful story of your parents, you know, history and coming to this country and what they navigated and to some extent what you navigated. And, you know, when I read that, not only was I sold on you, and I mean sold in a positive sense, I liked you, I wanted to read the book. And then I began to wonder, was that your attempt to build trust with your readers by showing that vulnerability up front? So that was my question, kind of my theory. All right, go ahead and share the reality.
Well, it's an interesting theory. So I think in a way, I saw it in the opposite direction, but okay. It may have had the implication that you're raising. Mm-hmm. And so for me, this was my attempt to trust the audience and mm-hmm. say, here's a story that I really don't share with people. And I want to let you all in just so you understand my perspective and understand that this is not just a neutral topic for me, that even sure. though I study this objectively, I have this has personal resonance for me. And it touches on a phenomenon that connects to what you raised. And it's that when you trust others, they wind up trusting you back, right? So there's
that
this
reciprocity effect, right?
Right, exactly.
Yeah, yeah. Such a powerful, powerful item. So, I mean, you had already highlighted it. I'm going to read. I'm looking on screen here and reading from your words. It's hard to overstate the importance of trust in society. Plus, trust plays a central role in how we navigate every aspect of our social world. Yet, despite that importance, it has become clear in my own life and as a research scientist studying this topic that we generally assess the trustworthiness of others quite poorly. You just kind of gently or not so gently punch us in the nose intellectually with that statement from the beginning. What do we get wrong? What do we get wrong, Peter?
Well, in a way, every chapter of the book, almost every chapter of the book mm-hmm. is designed to focus on a different aspect of this issue that we get wrong. So, for example, the first chapter is intended to highlight the assumption that most people have that trust starts at zero and mm-hmm. only builds gradually over time as we get to know one another. And so that chapter is intended to not only explain what trust is, how it develops, but also to make the case that actually we don't navigate the world with that assumption. Mm-hmm. In fact, if we did, we'd never be able to leave our homes because we'd be worried that people would, you know, stab us in the back or shoot us, you know, on the street. So it would be a very dysfunctional way of operating through the world. And most of us don't do sure. that. And so that would be one of the things we get wrong. And I'm sure we'll touch on other things we get wrong as we talk further.
It's just fascinating that that we do that. So I have to ask, and that's one of those things that I mentioned in the pre-talk, that notion that your research suggests that we actually kind of start from trust. Yet in my experience in the business environment, and by the way, I don't have 20 years of research, just anecdotal, and we're all victims of our own background, right? So with management teams, especially senior management teams, let's imagine a new member joins. Or in the matrix environment that so many of our organizations navigate, where project teams are assembled, individuals may never have worked together, may know a little bit about each other, may not know about each other. I don't find that trust is immediate. Now, maybe with senior management, it can be those political power related issues, but even with project team members, give me some feedback on that, because your whole book is kind of saying, hey, Art, maybe you've been looking at it wrong, or maybe, Art, you are wrong. So am I wrong, Peter?
Well, I don't think it's a matter of right and wrong as much as a matter of degree. So the case that the book it starts with is that trust doesn't start at zero, which in the context that you're describing would involve the sense that as people are coming into the room, you know, you start checking your wallets and you think that they're going to, you know, commit physical violence and things like that, that could happen in other settings. So we don't necessarily trust at 100%. And there are certainly issues that would lead us to place less trust in others, depending on the situation, depending on the cues we get. Mm-hmm. And so those are important to consider. So the level of risk you're undertaking would certainly mm-hmm. give you pause, whether or not this is a make or break moment for your company. And if they don't handle this well, you may go bankrupt. That certainly would raise concerns. If there are questions about motives, if you think that you're in a situation where the company may have the incentive to really take advantage of you, a strong mm-hmm. incentive, that matters as well. And so there are a variety of things that can affect that initial trust. And so that gets to the fact that we are not only highly, we're not only inclined to trust as a bias, but that we're also quite sensitive to cues that may lead us to revise that assumption. And all of that may happen within the first few minutes of an encounter. And so one of the reasons why we might trust, for example, gets to the assumption that the situation would promote trustworthy behavior, mm-hmm. that for rational people in the situation, even though you don't know them, the laws, norms, and rules would essentially lead any person who is rational to act in a trustworthy way, because it wouldn't be in their interest to do otherwise. So this gets to the idea that, you know, you don't necessarily expect the people who you meet to pull out a gun and rob you in these business meetings, right?
Yeah, I think I've been in a couple of those, but no, thank goodness not. Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. I'm replaying, and again, we're all victims of our own background. One particular experience navigating the turnaround of a company, and after spending a day with the management team, of which I was one of the members, our board chair over dinner said, you know, you as a group don't trust each other enough to make the hard decisions in front of you. I initially mentally rankled at that. And then as I thought about later on, it's like, doggone it, he's right. We don't. And there are a couple of people on this team, I frankly don't trust their motivations. Mm-hmm. They had signaled that their motivations were more about protecting their turf and maintaining or even growing their power versus doing what was right for the organization in a tough situation. So, you know, that was an interesting scenario mm-hmm. there. I mean, any thoughts on that one?
Yeah, I think that gets to how one of the things that you need to do as a leader, as a manager, is mm-hmm. consider the incentives in the situation and think about what might be done to alter the incentives so that the rational thing would be to trust and to act in a trustworthy way. And so what you're describing is a situation where there may be strong incentives for people not to trust. Maybe the, you know, it's a risky situation, and if someone ventures something that they shouldn't, others will take advantage of them and get ahead by doing that. And so if that's the perception, and it may just be a perception, but a perception that may be sort of supported by the company culture or that environment, then that's certainly a problem. And you certainly see this when you look at the level of trust people exhibit in different parts of the world. So you see there are cultural expectations that can affect the baseline level of trust that you have. And so, again, this has nothing to do with the people involved, but to the extent that the incentive structure creates this, you know, the sense that, oh, they may actually benefit from getting away with this and they won't be punished. Like, for example, in countries where the legal system is not well developed, people spend an awful lot of time in business negotiations figuring out, can we trust one another because we can't trust the legal system?
Thus, the concept of guanqi, right? Isn't that effectively where that evolves from in Chinese culture?
Absolutely.
So, you know, again, by the way, thanks for the extra couch time here, shrink time here. You're going to have to send a bill on this one. So as I think about that scenario, that one individual in particular whose motives weren't trusted by several of us, I operate by the better person theory, which is I'm always going to try to be the better person. I work so hard for 4 years to build a relationship and to get beyond that. And frankly, I got metaphorically kicked in the teeth over and over again. And I failed to repair the relationship. Not that I had damaged it. I had failed to gain the support of the individual to repair the relationship. What could I have done, or what could someone who's facing that circumstance where motives are at question, what might they be able to do to attempt to rebuild trust? Or is that beyond our control in many cases?
To the extent that these motives are the result of this situational incentives, then the attention does need to be placed on the situation. How do you alter the incentives so that people aren't inclined to take advantage of you? There's a longstanding principle based on decades of research in social psychology that the situation has an enormous influence on our behavior, far more so than we'd like to believe. We'd like to believe that we as individuals can control these outcomes. But if you're in a situation where all the cards are stacked against you, there's very little that you can do from that standpoint. It's an uphill battle from the start. So you might start with that, you know, that situation. But beyond that, there are things that you might do as individuals on a relational level. I think one of the things that you described is that you have a disposition to trust. So it's in your nature. And some of us have that. I have it in myself. And others probably have a disposition not to trust. So there's certainly individual variance. And so maybe that was the kind of person that you encountered, someone who was predisposed not to trust.
I suspect you're right. Yeah.
And so those dispositional differences matter. And we can't necessarily do anything about that either. But what we do know is that those who are predisposed to trust actually wind up better off on the whole. So you may, I think based on the assumption that, trust should start at zero and only build gradually over time, that's based on the notion that everyone's opportunistic, that they're looking out to take advantage of you. And the evidence suggests that that's not the case. When we trust people, the natural inclination for those who are trusted is to prove us right. They see trust as a precious resource to preserve for the future. So in most cases, that's what happens. And so that leads people who are predisposed to trust to be happier, to nurture better relationships overall. Not every single time. There are always going to be people like the person that you mentioned.
just my fortune to run into it. No, I love this. And by the way, the great thing about this book is it challenged me to think and to think differently about the concept of trust. And that's, that's a testament. And you're doing a wonderful job supporting that here. So question. I noticed that you reference, and I don't know if it's two types or forms of trust, but kind of this competence-oriented trust and integrity-oriented. So would love for you to dig into that a little bit more. And I do have, before that, a lead-in question, which is that the same as what I've heard in more pop settings of head trust and heart trust? Cognitive, affective? I've heard those terms thrown around.
So they're associated in a sense that... when we make these judgments, we have both an automatic judgment, kind of a knee-jerk reaction to these situations, and then we can, with time and opportunity, reflect further on the situation. And so we have this initial heart reaction, right. And then we might think about this further. And so that is a tension that is discussed in the book in various ways. But the two types of trust that you brought up, competence and integrity, the reason that's important and that distinction is important is because we have these weird things in our mental basement that leads us to weigh information about these two things very differently. So when it comes to competence-related issues, we tend to weigh positive information much more heavily than negative information.
Okay.
So if you are a baseball player and you hit a home run, then you're considered a home run hitter, even though you might strike out the next time. That positive instance was considered very diagnostic, whereas the negative information was not considered diagnostic because there are lots of things that can lead even competent people not to perform well in a specific instance. Maybe you had an injury. Maybe, you know, the sun was in your eye and so on. So we can discount that negative piece of competence-related information.
Okay.
But for integrity-related information, that bias is reversed. So we tend to weigh negative information about integrity much more heavily than positive information about integrity. For example, if you're caught cheating on your spouse and you respond by saying, well, I didn't cheat on you yesterday, that's not going to work out so well.
Worst advice ever.
And it gets to the fact that we weigh that negative information about integrity, the fact that you did cheat, so much more heavily than the positive signals of that are conveyed by you deciding not to do that the next day, right? And it's because we believe that those with integrity would refrain from any immoral act regardless of the situation, whereas those who are immoral may either act ethically or unethically depending on the incentives. If they think they're going to get caught, they may not steal, right, for example.
Sure.
And so those different biases are important because so many of our attempts to repair trust, address a violation, are double-edged in nature. For example, if you apologize, an apology conveys both negative information about guilt, you did something wrong, you're acknowledging that, and positive signals of redemption. You're going to avoid this in the future through expressions of remorse and so on. Well, if it's conveying both of those signals, the type of violation matters a lot because for competence-related violations, we see, oh, you did this, but you're remorseful. So we weigh the positive signals more heavily than the negative signals. So an apology will work, or it's more likely to work for competence-related violations, but for integrity-related violations, what do? We focus on the acknowledgement of guilt that you did something that is a breach of integrity, and then we discount the positive signals that are conveyed that you're going to fix this moving forward. And so that's how the exact same response can lead to dramatically different reactions in people depending on how the violation is viewed.
So I think you have some fascinating comparison contrast in the book. In one instance, we have former President Clinton, and in another, we have Arnold Schwarzenegger, and both were effectively, I suppose, guilty of transgressions, and both apologized, yet I think the outcomes were a little bit different. Can you share a little bit about those scenarios?
Sure. So in a way, objectively, you would think that Schwarzenegger's violations were worse because at the time when this came out, as far as we knew, Bill Clinton's transgression was with one willing participant, the affair with Monica Lewinsky, whereas Schwarzenegger's scandal involved multiple unwilling victims. So from that perspective, you could say, okay, so Schwarzenegger should be worse off here.
Right.
But this is where the perception of the transgression matters. So for the Bill Clinton, Monica Lewinsky scandal, it was viewed as an integrity related violation. He had committed adultery and in the White House, no less, and so on. And so when he ultimately did apologize, that didn't work because it was seen as confirmation that he lacked integrity, that, you know, I'm sure people would not want their daughters to intern for him in moving forward. But Schwarzenegger did something masterful during the scandal that engulfed him. And this was when he was running for California governor. So all these allegations came out, and his response was different because he also apologized, but he did something first. His statement was something to the effect of, "I had no idea they would be offended. These were rowdy sets and these occurred in times where I thought we were just playing around. I had no idea that they would be offended by, you know, what I thought was just, you know, just playful behavior. If I had offended them, I am deeply sorry." So he first reframed this incident from a matter of integrity to a matter of competence before he apologized. He attributed this to a faulty social barometer. He was just socially clueless. And if this indeed offended people, of course he's sorry. So, you know, I'm sure that didn't convince everybody, but it convinced enough people where he ultimately won
governor,
the election.
Right. And he's back in the, you know, mainstream and taking on acting roles. So, by the way, just as a sideline, I've identified a new sideline for you for all of the apologizing that needs to go on in society. Perhaps you could help advise individuals on how to optimize and best frame and position their apologies. There's a whole new opportunity. Remember, you heard it here.
that was one of the reservations I had about writing the book in the first place. I thought I would get calls from the mobs. I don't respond to these scandals.
Let's hope you don't get any of those.
Exactly.
Hey, so related, you and I had the great privilege of attending a number of exec courses hosted by the late Keith Murnaghan at Northwestern's Kellogg. You were there at Northwestern. And in Keith's book, Do Nothing, which I actually love as a management book, I love the label and the title of it and the content he has, he introduces the concept of swift trust, which is effectively whatever it is you're getting together with a new project team, move quickly towards trust with them, even though you don't have history and examples, because time to trust equals time to performance. Give me some feedback on this notion of swift trust. I'm trying to guide my audience into how they can do a better job with trust. And if, in fact, by the way, that statement of time to trust equals time to performance holds based on your research. And that was a compound set of issues if there ever were. So sorry about that. You'll unpack it if you can.
Sure. Swift trust is, it's very much aligned with the premise that trust doesn't start at zero, that we start with this initial presumption of trustworthiness. And sometimes that's the result of, as we talked about, the incentives in the situation. So if you are meeting in a project team and you all need to get this work done because you're all facing this deadline, the incentives are very clear. You either work together to get this done or things fall apart and all your careers are harmed as a result. And so the motivations are more clearly mm-hmm. aligned to allow for trust to operate there, even though you might not know them at all. And so that clearly operates in those settings. And I would venture that we have this with trust in all other, you know, so many other aspects of our lives. Every time we go to a restaurant, for example, you know, sometimes I have conversations with people who say, oh, I don't trust anyone. And yet they're eating from a plate that was assembled by a host of people they didn't know, you know, distributors,
with food that
farmers.
Came from somewhere and we don't know how it was cleaned. By the way, you did, spoiler alert, you did share an example where that didn't work out so well from you, but in a lifetime, that was one or two, one of a couple of examples, right?
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. So I went to Mexico City earlier this year and I really experienced the downside of Swiss trust in a big way. I was infected with three forms of E. coli and a norovirus from this one trip.
You hit for the cycle there in baseball terms. Wow.
Yeah, I was definitely ill and it was a horrible experience. And so that might, you know, be a data point that would lead people to suggest, well, then you shouldn't trust at all. Mm-hmm. But if I were to reflect on this experience, I would have to also consider all the other times in which I've dined in restaurants all around the world. I've done that for decades. And this is the first time I ever got sick from dining at a restaurant. I got mm-hmm. sick through food poisoning once before, but that was from dining at home when I was a child. So, right. So in terms of a track record, it's a pretty damn good mm-hmm. track record. And the upside of that has been that I've been able to amass these amazing experiences mm-hmm. with chatting with people and visiting locations that I would not have been able to visit mm-hmm. if I didn't have this initial trust.
So, you know what, of the many things I love about your book, I like that it both goes after the individual component, the group component, and kind of the nation state or society at large perspective. You introduce examples that run from celebrities and politics, as we discussed, President Clinton, Arnold Schwarzenegger. You also tap into literature a little bit. And one of my famous scenarios in here is your reference to the Steinbeck book, East of Eden. What was it that had you share that? What should we take away from that?
Mm. Well, it's one of my favorite books. Mm-hmm. It had a major impact on me when I was reading it in college. And I think, well, first of all, I read it at a difficult time in my life. So it had a very positive impact on me in that sense. But, you know, Steinbeck was a humanist. And so he believed in the good in all of us. And from that perspective, I think that resonated. But with that story in particular, you know, it's a story about someone who didn't know if he could be a good person. And I think this is very much connected to this challenge that we have with trust in society. It gets to this question of who are we? Who are the people we're interacting with? Are they good people? Are we good people? Are we seen as good people? How does that perception affect how we see ourselves? Mm-hmm. And that is ultimately this, well, we might call this an identity negotiation. You know, we might think about business negotiations, you know, where we deal with the widgets and delivery mm-hmm. date and so on. But how do we determine who we are, and how do we determine how, you know, the trustworthiness and the goodness of others? I think that is a core question. And you know, this issue of trust, its violation and its repair, is ultimately about guilt and redemption, right? Mm-hmm. These are the basis of some of our most foundational stories. So I found a lot of connections to his book because it's, and especially the passage that I discuss at the end, because, you know, it really is about how we live our lives and what it means when people might do bad things, and does it mean that they're fundamentally bad people, or are they just trying to take shortcuts to the things that they ultimately want to achieve?
It was a brilliant section of your book, and frankly, instead of making it an assignment from my literature class in high school, I'm going to go back and reread the book at your recommendation. So, with a new frame and a new filter. So, hey, just a couple of more big, bold questions here, and then we'll let you get on with your day. So, can we repair trust in democracy?
I have to believe that we can, in part because the alternative is so terrible.
It's really bad. Yeah.
I think what it will take is for us to adjust certain patterns that we have been magnifying in society. And one of the big issues that the book explores is this issue of, well, are we looking at these situations too simplistically? Mm-hmm. Do we need to consider other ways of viewing the exact same incident? Because many situations are not so clear cut. And so a lot of this requires that we consider, how are we making these judgments of competence versus integrity? Because many transgressions involve both or are so multifaceted that it's hard to make that distinction. And then there's this other question of, what does integrity even mean? Mm-hmm. Because on the one hand, we'd like to think that, we know what's, ethical or unethical and so on. But it turns out that the research underscores how, even though all of us may share the same innate values, the same set of innate values, we might prioritize those values differently in the real world. And so when we are interacting with others who might have slightly different priorities in terms of the ethical principles, it is very easy for us to infer that because they're not doing what we would do, that their integrity must be low.
Right.
And if we're not thinking about the situation is in a sophisticated, comprehensive way, that's a very easy thing to do. And that's where dialogue is so important, where you get different perspectives on the situation, where you hear their stories about why they might have done something. Maybe they have very good reasons. Maybe they're not sociopaths. Maybe they're
that dialogue concept, it's what's missing, right? And to some extent, my theory, social media has amplified that. We're all shouting, but nobody's listening.
Exactly. And that's a major problem, because the media has allowed that to happen and nurtured that approach. And we're never going to get to a solution if that's how things remain, because it's not only this issue of only listening to the people that share your views that creates a problem, because that will make your views even more extreme and make you even more confident in condemning the integrity of others. It will ultimately, be exacerbated by the fact that those in the other media streams are not like you. And so there's this outgroup effect that makes it worse. And so the problem I think we see again and again, not only in the US, but in many kinds of disputes along these lines that occurs in the international sphere, for example, is that our natural tendency is to gravitate towards domination. We want to say that you haven't done what I think should have been done, so you lack integrity and we condemn them.
Right.
And then they do the same thing for us. And so we wind up talking past one another. We need to move from that position to the kind of dialogue that we've been talking about. We don't do that naturally. And it turns out what is necessary for that to happen is for us to reach a state where we realize, each side realizes, that attempt to dominate isn't working, and that we're stuck in a position where, things are not good and it's an uncomfortable place. And that's what ultimately leads to the kind of dialogue that we need.
I mean, again, another reason why this book is the right book at the right time, I think, right now, no doubt about it. So for any time we sit down to explore a book, we're making a commitment of a multi-hour relationship with someone. How should someone approach your book, and what's a little bit of the suggestion that they'll take away from it, or what do you want them to take away from it?
Well, the book is a little bit challenging on multiple levels. On the one hand, it challenges you, all of us, to take stock of our assumptions and to be aware of this possibility that we're not so good at this. And so it requires that sort of mindset, and it requires a willingness to delve into the nuances rather than resort to the quick fixes. Mm-hmm. So this takes hard work to really grasp these ideas and really put them into practice. But I think the message really is that hard work is worth it. I mean, given how important trust is to all of us, this is going to be enormously important. And if you manage to really think about these issues with an open mind, that you will reap the benefits for the rest of your life.
What a great setup for it. My perspective, well worth the time investment. You form a relationship, you go on a journey, you're exposed to so many different angles. It will challenge you to think and think differently about this critical topic. My last question for you, Peter. My experience has been that every author learns something about themselves or something about the topic. They come away from writing a book just a little bit different, a little bit changed. What was it that you gained from the experience of writing this book?
For me, it has been an amazing experience on multiple levels, in part because it has opened up this whole new world maybe has been neglected too long. You know, it's easy for me to keep doing the science and share little tidbits with my students and so on. But to engage with the broader world, with people like you, and have these thoughtful conversations, that's been one of the most gratifying aspects of this effort, to really see people connect with these ideas and to see that it is making a difference in people's lives. So that's been one of the most gratifying things about it.
Tremendous. I think we'll be talking about your book and you for quite a long time. There's so much more to build on, so much more, I suspect, in the world of research for you. But I have to tell you, as capping things off here, thank you for sharing your research, your hard work. Mostly of all, thank you for sharing you and all of the wisdom that you bring to this process. It was a delight to read your wonderful book. It was more than a delight to chat with you here. Thank you, Peter.
Thank you, Art. It's been an honor chatting with you. I really love this thoughtful conversation.
Same here. Take care now.